Hi, this is Dr. Steven from OutKlig Magazine. Today we're excited to talk to Victor Gimenez, who is the Executive Director of the OUTShine LGBTQ Plus Film Festival. Victor, welcome today to the program.
Great having me. Thank you for having me here today. I'm looking forward to the interview and letting you know all the exciting stuff we're doing new this year.
Thank you. The OUTShine Film Festival, you guys always have so many great films. The after parties, the before parties, everything is always just such a great, great event. We know you've been impacted by COVID like everyone else, but you have forged on and created some new exciting things for people to be a part of. And we want to let people know what you all are doing this year in response to the COVID. But let's pretend like my first question, someone has not heard of the OUTShine Film Festival. If you want to give us an overview first of what is the festival?
So yeah, OUTShine is the local LGBTQ plus film festival. We've been around for 22 years. We started in Miami 22 years ago, and then we 12 years ago, we branched off into Fort Lauderdale. And then a few years back, we rebranded as one OUTShine Film Festival with a Miami edition and a Fort Lauderdale edition. And then our mission is to inspire, entertain, and educate, and then create a sense of community in the sharing of our story. You know, representation matters. And knowing that our stories are being recorded and shared and our history being saved is kind of the main mission of the festival, is to make sure that, you know, we are heard, we're not forgotten, and that people that might be in the closet or feel that they're alone know that they're not alone and that we exist. And that's kind of the history of the festival in a nutshell.
You do a great job with a variety of films, films from across the world, independent films. We've got a YouTube video we want to show of why these kinds of festivals are so important and some of the history of it. I'm gonna ask Arthur, who helps me in the background, we're gonna pop in this YouTube video to show people kind of some of the history and what it's like under normal conditions and really how much fun the festivals are. Arthur, if you can pop that video in.
Festivals are so important, not just because they provide opportunities for LGBTQ filmmakers, but also because they create a community. Festivals like OUTShine create a community for the filmmakers, not just in Miami, but across the country, to come together and really get to know one another's work.
This is the most beautiful vehicle for an independent filmmaker who does LGBTQ content, because the audiences are so grateful to see themselves represented.
It's just an art form that lends itself to being able to really tell the nuances of personal experience with a film festival, or like in a space like what we have, to be able to then share that with other people that can connect on these very like kind of specific experiences is just really powerful. So I think in that sense, it also builds community, just being able to see it on a big screen, because then you know it's not just my individual experience, but that there's like other people out there who can relate.
And we always encourage people, when you come to the movies, come there before with your friends, watch the movies, mm-hmm. and then have drinks afterwards or watch another movie and just talk about the films that you have. And then we always try to do different events where people then, you know, watch the movie and then go to the party afterwards and continue the conversation about the movie they just saw and hopefully meet somebody new that was in the same theater. Hey, what did you think of this movie? I saw that you were in there, and then talk about it.
I think it's hugely important. I think you have to support each other as filmmakers, as, you know, people of the community, and to showcase great projects.
And a lot of times projects like these and like ours don't have a huge production budget or a way to spread the word about their shows or films. So it's great to have an opportunity to come together, be in the same space, and see what everyone else is working on and hear everyone else's stories and support each other.
There's so many things that I'll see at a film festival that you don't know for sure whether it's going to get represented or whether it's actually going to get sold. And so you get to see some really creative, cool stuff. I'm saying that in case anyone sees my film. It's like, oh my God, what the hell was going on there? It's very creative.
We probably got 400 plus submissions, and we, in the festival, I would say we probably had 42 feature length films and then another 40 total of like shorts throughout the whole festival.
I like going to the festivals because for sure, I love supporting this. But truly, I like going to the festivals because it just takes me into another world. So for me, it's all entertainment. Support and entertainment.
I really enjoy meeting the filmmakers, the directors and the talent, kind of hearing their stories of like, what, you know, why they made the films and also the challenges they had faced making the films. And then I like being an avenue for their films to actually be shown. Then being there for the audience to experience it with the filmmakers, the Q&As. Q&As are always interesting because there's always going to be someone that in the audience that identifies with the story and the point of view. And that's really the part that I like the most, when those conversations happen. I've been asked, oh, is there a point to have an LGBT film festival anymore? And I go, the reality is yes.
People say, oh, are they going to last? As our culture starts to merge mainstream, it will last because we need our space.
A movie made by a big studio that's a queer movie is kind of designed for a mainstream audience and not necessarily an LGBT audience, as opposed to the films that come into like our festival and any other queer film festival. It's just a different point of view that's really more our point of view. And that's why it's important.
Whether we start to merge more into mainstream and as it becomes easier to be part of just one culture, which is what ultimately our goal is, truly, we always need this. Any community, any minority, any people that are marginalized deserve and should have their own space that's for them, by them, about them.
That's great. When I talked to Rachel Mason, who is the writer and director of Circus of Books, a Netflix series, a Netflix original documentary. And one of the things in watching it, I noticed is that it's not just the story. It's preserving that part of history, that part of our history that would have been lost if she had not done that documentary. And one of the things that OUTShine Film Festival does is that it presents an ethnographical study, so much of our LGBTQ history, and presents it in a way for people to have the dialogue. It's not just about the films. It's about preserving our history and about telling our story and about those conversations, engaging people in those conversations in ways that are meaningful and in ways that eventually change our culture and change the minds of people. Maybe if you could speak on that a little bit and how the film festival does that.
Well, you know, it's kind of, you kind of hit it on the head. You know, one of things that we want to do is make sure we create a great avenue for different stories to be told, you know, to show that, yeah, we're different, but we're also very similar. One of the comments, I remember one of our members saying last year is I like sitting down in the movie theater, being transported to a different culture in a different country I wasn't aware of and experience how it is to be gay or lesbian in that culture. On the flip side with documentaries, you know, there's also, you learn certain histories that may have been forgotten. You know, the whether it's just stories that you're just not aware of, or you were kind of aware of them and then you kind of forgot about them, and then all of a sudden there's a documentary about it to throw focus in it. And it's when it's our own filmmakers, you know, LGBT filmmakers creating these stories, they are presented it from their, you know, from that point of view, and there is a difference as opposed to when a mainstream studio makes a film. And I think that that's an important distinction between LGBT produced films for an LGBT audience and just a mainstream produced film for a mainstream audience. They're both important, but there are nuances to the stories that we show as compared to what's like a big budget or a mainstream release.
And you bring a lot of the writers, directors, actors, you bring them here and get and let people, under normal conditions, you bring them and we get to meet them, we get to chat with them. That's something so unique to the festival that's so interesting and fascinating.
Yeah, definitely. You know, the comment was there, I made it as one of my favorite parts is like listening what the audience will ask of the filmmakers and talents that are there, because sometimes there is someone that either has a unique connection to that film that it's always this question that to me came out of left field, but it's a great question. You know, we're still going to have this year with the virtual festival a lot of Q&As, a lot of live Q&As, so we're still going to be able to replicate that, you know, through Zoom or StreamYard where people can chat in their questions. But we're also doing a lot of recorded Q&As for those areas where the time change is just too much to accommodate a live one. So we're still going to have that there. We're actually going to have more Q&As with this festival than we've had probably ever. Just a different experience of it. But we're still going to have those live Q&As.
Yeah. So let's. I'm going to have Arthur bring up the website. This year, the festival is going to be August 20th through the 30th. Mm-hmm. If you could, we're going to bring that website up right now. He's got to switch. Takes him a second to switch. So Outshine, we'll scroll up. Your opening night drive out event at the drive-in, if I've got all of that correct, is August 20th, Stage Mother.
Correct. And if you want, you can just go to click on the Films and Virtual Festival, and then you'll kind of see everything there. But yeah, it was important for us to have one actual live event, if at all possible. And then luckily, we were able to do that with the drive, what we're calling the drive out event, which is, a drive-in experience for Stage Mother. So yeah, it's going to be great. We're going to have food trucks there, a little gift bag when you leave. We're going to have the director and the screenwriter there for a Q&A afterwards by Skype. So at least we have that one physical event where people can show up, you'll be in your cars, with the great social distancing. And then after that, everything.
This is the good old fashioned drive-in, my parents used to do.
Correct.
So this is something that is fun to do. We did this with Flip with the Fort Lauderdale International Film Festival, and we had a blast. It is a good time to go out and do this. And this is going to be August the 20th at the Desertland. Do I have that correct? Park in Miami. I want to make sure we've got okay. Do you want us to play the trailer of this?
Yeah, go ahead. Play the trailer for Stage Mother.
Let's play the trailer of this. We'll get it pulled back in. We had a blast with this with the Fort Lauderdale National Film Festival. We went and got food trucks and had popcorn. And I have a convertible. We put the top down until it rained. And we had a blast with this. It's the good old-fashioned, drive-in. But let's see if we can get it pulled up here. Or the old style picture in a picture too. Remember when TV used to be picture in a picture you were trying to watch?
All right. Well, that was neither amazing nor graceful.
Now that's my favorite line right there.
No!
Where do you think you're going?
One of us has to go. Make sure he's put to rest properly.
Ricky Metcalf was a big, flaming comet. More laughter, more joy, more mascara.
Are you Ricky's mom from Texas? Ricky and I are best friends.
Is Ricky the baby's father?
Oh, definitely not.
Do you know who is?
Yeah, like 90-something%.
There you go. Police, keys, contracts. Ricky owned Pandora's box.
Oh my Lord, I've inherited a gay bar.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dusty Muffin. And I gotta warn you, this muffin has nuts.
I'd suggest you mingle, but I don't think you have much in common with this crowd.
Not really much of a crowd.
Is Mommy Dearest going to be our new boss?
Do I call them boys or girls?
No, it's kind of a time of day issue.
Our most popular performers just quit. Business is flatlining.
I have a plan.
What do you know about running a drag bar?
And do you have a maximum number that you can take at the drive-in?
They can hold up to like 250 cars.
250.
Like Sing Sing? Really?
You're going to tune in through the audio at the other of the
all
car.
Right, bitches, get dressed.
Yeah, when you get in, they'll tell you what radio station you're tuning to, or frequency. I think it's 107.1, but we'll have it up there.
And we'll have it up there. A lot to say.
And you're going to have food trucks, is that right?
Yeah, it's good. Beforehand, we're going to send out, like letting you know what the food trucks are in their menu, and you can actually pre-order your food, and then and you only have to have your car.
Going on here, maybe.
And then also while you're there, you're gonna have complimentary popcorn for becoming a popcorn bag. You can put your food in order there if you want, and they'll bring you the food. I try to make it as easy as possible for everybody.
Can you bring in outside food, like you bring in a pizza in the car? And is that?
Yeah, nothing will prevent you. If you want to bring in your water and your soda and Subway or whatever it is in the car, that's not a problem.
All right. That sounds like fun. So that's August the 20th. Mm-hmm. And then on August the 26th is your centerpiece film. Arthur, if you want to bring up that on the website, tell us about The Goddess of Fortune.
It's an Italian film, a gay couple in Italy, and then also their life kind of gets thrown into turmoil when one of their friends, she shows up with her two kids and asks them to watch the two kids for a few days while she's doing some paperwork which she just couldn't have her kids with her. And it kind of throws their already rocky relationship into a little bit of a tizzy. And that's what I'll give you for now.
Okay. Let's see. We can play the trailer on that one too. I think the trailer on that one's pretty short, but this one looks fun too.
Yeah.
We may have to reshare the audio on it, but let's see if it shares the audio. There we go.
Mi siete piaciuti subito.
Is that the right one?
It is the right one, but I just realized we do have an English language trailer right now, but then you just corrected one of my errors. We haven't pushed it out to one of the subtitles.
All right. Yeah. I'll go back since it's not in English. Very good.
The trailer's actually still good. You get the...
Oh, okay. Okay, we'll watch it.
Divertito. Arto che fa il geloso. Non ho fatto niente di male.
C'è una luna turchese diamante stanotte che può spezzarmi il cuore. Tu con le tue mani, io con i miei occhi, con la mia bocca, tornando a casa, aiutiamoci a ricominciare, vestita come una signora, solo per farmi amare, ma non sono sicura che non sia tardi stanotte per tutti e due.
Very good. Well, it is a multi-language film festival, which is also an added bonus. You have a lot of good variety. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, with our centerpiece film and also the closing night film, they're like going to be actual virtual experiences. Like all, like starting the 21st, all the when the festival goes live virtually, you know, all the films will have a specific release date and time. But then after that, like let's say it's Friday, 7 p.m., for the following 4 days, you can actually watch that film whenever you want. So Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. But for films like our centerpiece film, The Goddess of Fortune, we're creating like a virtual event around it. So there'll be beforehand, there'll be almost a reception beforehand with a live intro that we're talking. You watch the film. And then afterwards, we'll have a virtual event afterwards with like entertainment. Q&A and that whole experience. So it kind of elevates that film and the closing night film to something a little bit more. But again, since it is a streamed film, if for whatever reason you can't watch it Wednesday at 7 p.m., for the following 4 days, you can watch it whenever you want.
Okay. So it's going to be broadcast at that particular time, then it'll be available online. What do they watch it directly on the website, or what platform is it going to be available, Victor?
So the way it works is you buy your tickets at our website, and then you'll get a confirmation. You'll be taken to a confirmation page, and also get a confirmation email. And then in there, you'll see there's like a button for you to click onto the service, and there'll be an access code there. So like right now, if you were to buy the tickets, you couldn't get access to anything. But once we're live with everything, you'll click on that button. It'll take you to our streaming service, which is Film Highway. And there on the right-hand side of the screen, you'll see all the films that you have access to that you purchase. And you basically click on the film and you start watching it. And then, like I said, we do have a release schedule when the films are available. So if the film doesn't get released till Tuesday and you click on it before Tuesday, it'll just say, oh, this film becomes available Tuesday at 7 p.m. or whatever time it is. But once it's available, it's there for 4 days, and you can watch it at your convenience. And you can access everything through our website. You'll see there's a button, you know, watch films here, and it'll still direct you to the streaming service. And then all you do is enter in your 9-digit access code, and then the system will know exactly what films you have access to, and then you can start watching them.
Okay, so they purchase it through the website,
correct?
And then there'll be a watch which directs you to, mm-hmm. And then they watch it through the regular browser. It sounds like,
yeah, correct. You'll watch it, basically on your mobile device, on your computer. If you have a smart TV that's already tied into these devices, mm-hmm. You can basically throw it onto the large screen and watch it there. If you can already access a website through your TV, you can just access it right there, and it's already on your TV. So if you already have the capability of watching stuff that you would normally watch on a computer and your mobile device on your big screen TV, you can still do it for the film festival. And we encourage you to do it that way too.
What I'm telling people for all of this online content, it's so well done. It's in HD, is by a Chromecast or still time, a Chromecast, an Apple TV. There's a couple others that you can mirror a Fire Stick. I think that you can mirror the content to the large TV. It makes for a completely different viewing experience. I have watched Jennifer McClain and everyone on the big screen TV, and it just really makes for a fun night after having not contact with anyone to sit and watch them on the big screen TV. I watched Michael Walters, and I had more purple hair in my bedroom than I ever thought possible. And these videos would be great. So I'm encouraging people to do that. And, you know, watch them on the big TV, grab some popcorn and watch them and make a night of it, and be interactive with the opportunities that you have.
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to look at, let's look at the closing night film too that you've got coming.
Yeah,
that's
definitely
a great one too.
Yeah, that's Single Street, mm-hmm. a film with a different point of view. It's from the Netherlands, and this one does have the title, so you can follow along.
All right, let's put that one up. That will be released Sunday, August 30th at 7 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
Ik ben Mo. Ik heb een ongewoon beroep. Ik snij mensen open en sleutel aan hun belangrijkste orgaan.
Maar je doet het toch nog wel, hè?
Pap, wat is dat nou voor een vraag van een vader aan de dochter?
Een directe, denk ik.
Nou, Ja?
Ik ben Max.
Monique.
Je woont hier?
Ja.
Dat is mooi, want daar wil ik het graag even met je over hebben. Ik wil het graag huren.
Je appt hem gewoon nu en je zegt gewoon, ik ga akkoord. Lekker ding. Nee, oké, je zegt nu gewoon, ik ga akkoord. En dan later zeg je lekker ding in zo'n smoel.
Hey.
Hey.
Wil je mijn werk zien?
Hoe lang doe je nou voor zo'n ding?
Ding?
Figuur.
Een beetje ongeveer.
Wat de verhaal blijft! Hij eruit! Ja!
Wat nap zeg, je verliest mijn hoop. Oh.
Want als je homo bent, dan kan je niet vechten. Dat is discriminatie, hoor.
Jij bent verliest. Nee, joh. Tuurlijk niet, het is homo. Ja, nou dus. Hey. Hoe weet je dan zo snel dat hij het ook is?
Homo's die vinden elkaar gewoon heel snel.
En of hij je leuk vindt, zie je dat dan ook zo snel?
Want of hij me leuk vindt. Ik denk dat het iets subjectiefs is. Ik ben leuk. Heb je zonder wat te doen?
Nee.
Het is mooi, hè? Nou, dat zou ik ook graag willen, hoor, kinderen.
Ik ben er totaal niet mee bezig.
Dit is Gene Matching, een kinderwens koppelsite. Oh. Dit is Marleen trouwens.
Hallo, ik ben Monique.
Jij bent de buurvrouw.
Ja, zeker. Ik ben ook de buurvrouw, ja.
Je kijkt naar een vrouwenlichaam als naar een bijzettafeltje of een duikbril.
Waarom is ze dan toevallig drop dead gorgeous?
Ah.
Ik kijk even met een fotografisch oog.
Mensen, dieren, voorwerpen, iets waarmee je als het echt moest seks op kunnen hebben. Klassiek dilemma. Een mooie vrouw, lelijke man, twee honden. Wat tot die vrouw maar.
Ja. This looks like a good one too. Victor, how do you select the movies? Who has control of the content? I've always wondered that question.
So yeah, we have a screening committee, and the way it basically works, and it's a volunteer screening committee, and it's made up about probably 14 to 16 people. And then as we get the submissions in, it goes to the screening committee, and basically anything, let's say, and the films are divided up into different groups. People watch the films. Anything that's really bad kind of gets removed from the list. Anything really good gets moved up. Things in the middle kind of stay in the group to further discussion. And then from there, it kind of goes to the programmer, who's our, Joe Belancio, myself, to kind of like see, okay, and then the head of the screening committee to kind of determine, okay, what is the program going to look like? What are the films that are going to be in it? What's the kind of flow of the schedule? And then we kind of determine our program off that with a few, bubble films, films that will come in or come out just depending on what the other films that we get. And then we reach out to the distributors and filmmakers and secure them. But it is a very community-based process. You know, we get a ton of films. There's no way that one person can go through all of them. And then they screen through the whole system, and then they move the films forward to like actually get to the programming phase, which involves myself, Joe Belancio, and the head of the screening committee. And then it's a very collaborative process, and then we go from there.
I've always wondered, because I'm sure you have to review so many to become part of the process. I've always wondered how that becomes in the rating system and the collaborative process.
It's funny, people. It's actually a great committee to be on. It does take a lot of time, and I think everyone kind of goes in expecting all the films to be great. Some people are a little bit heartbroken sometimes if they get a bad batch of films. And I always say, look, a bad movie is a bad movie, and your job is to kind of go through it to make sure we have the best product, up there on the screen for people to watch. And then, sometimes there are some bad bad films, but the screening committee does a really excellent job of just going through the films and also just giving us a flavor of what the audience wants. Mm-hmm. There is a separate Miami committee and a separate Fort Lauderdale committee because they are two different areas. This year, obviously, we had worked on already in Miami, and the Fort Lauderdale was working. We kind of created this combined program to hopefully, make the two different audiences enjoy everything. And actually this year, as different from other years, we're not tied to a physical location for the festival. We're actually, we can promote to the entire state of Florida, and we are, and anyone within the state of Florida can actually watch and enjoy our films.
Mm. This may open up some brand new avenues that the film festival had never, thought of. There's always opportunities. There's new opportunities. So maybe this will branch out in ways that we hadn't even thought of before. It's not the same as being in person and in-person conversations. But we're all making the best of it, which kind of transitions into my question about you are doing the Q&A's online with the filmmakers and doing some interactive Zoom events. Mm. And you said that was right after the film's airing, and so that will be available online.
Yeah. So the way that'll work is as much as possible, we'll have recorded Q&A's, but usually.
Okay.
But we're gonna have a lot of live Q&A's also, just to be aware.
Okay.
Like the 7 p.m. films and all that, and then some of the late night ones also. After you watch the film in the streaming service, let's say you minimize it, you'll see there's a button called Chat Back, and you'll click on that button, and then it'll take you to where the Q&As are going to be. So if it's a 7 p.m. Friday night film, we're going to have a live Q&A afterwards. Once you finish watching that film, you click on it, it'll take you to where we're doing the live Q&A. If you watch that film that 7 p.m. on a Friday night, but you watch it like 2 days later, because you hit that chat back button, it'll take you to the, what would have been the live event. You want to be part of the, at least listen to the Q&A. And that's the way to work for the recorded Q&As also. Even if you watch it when the film goes live and the movie ends at 11:30, you hit that chat back button, it'll take you to the Q&A that we have recorded for it. So you'll be able to be part of it. We always encourage you to be there for the live Q&As because, like I said earlier, it's always interesting what the audience questions will be. And there's always interesting points of view in there that I really do enjoy. So as much as possible, we're going for the live Q&As. And then we're making it as easy as possible for you to access, you know, get to them after you watch the film by just hitting that chat back button, and it'll take you to the live Q&A.
Very good. Very good. Arthur, let's put up the website so they can see where to buy tickets again with the ticket link. If we can pop that in, we'll give him a second to pull that up so we can show the ticket link. So you've got that. And all of the films are up to date and listed for what you have.
Correct. Yes.
Okay. So we'll get that up there too. And they are, where is the ticket link?
We'll make you'll sure see we've like, got
it right there where it says buy tickets right there.
Yeah. And then every film letters. Is there too, but you click on that. Okay. It'll redirect you to the film, the ticket purchasing page.
Okay.
And then it'll boot up there, and then you scroll down and then you keep going, and you can purchase a membership and ticket packages there.
Okay.
We got different membership levels, different ticket packages, the all access pass, the purchase 5 films, you get a 6 free. And then in that case, you clicked on one of the high dollar memberships, so that everything gets included. So if you unclick that, just click on the virtual membership. And now you scroll down and you'll see the listing of all the, you can keep scrolling down. And then you see the listing of all the films in the website. And then also, if you want to learn more about each film, there's a little learn more button. You can click on it. It'll take you to the actual individual film page to learn more about it. And then you go from there. And then it's basically pick on the movies you want, and then put your billing information in, hit submit, and then you'll get your confirmation email. And then once the films are live, you can start watching.
Very good. Very good. Well, we look forward to this year's event, Victor. We know you've worked very hard to put together some really quality films again. Is there anything I didn't ask that you wanted to cover?
I think we covered a lot. I will say I want to give my appreciation for the Cultural Arts Department for Miami-Dade County. Reason being is they're definitely working with all, not just us, but with all arts and cultural organizations that they give grants to make sure that, you know, they're going through this whole time and they survive it. Matter of fact, they just created a relief grant that we're in the process of applying to that is looking good, that we'll get additional funds to make sure that in the festival's still here for you next year. We've done, I think, an excellent job bringing you this, you know, adapting to these very surreal times with the COVID-19. We have the virtual festival going on for you. And we ask you to support us. We are a 501c3 not-for-profit organization. I encourage you to make a donation, become a member, buy tickets to the screenings. We are in a fairly decent spot here, but you know, the COVID-19 is not just the issue in 2020. It's going to be an issue in 2021. You know, the longer it takes before the vaccine happens, the more stuff affects. So just be aware of that, you know, we're all suffering, but anything you can do to help us continue providing great content for you, we would greatly appreciate it. And then definitely go to our website, outshinefilm.com, take a look at our films, and go watch what you like, and then enjoy the show.
I think we're all wondering how long this will last. We thought it would be the summer, and now we're thinking the rest of 2020, and now I think we're wondering how much through 2021, and even if it lasts through 2021 or whatever the end of year, how that's impacting groups like yours and planning for 2021. So one of the questions I ask everyone at the end of every program is, what words of encouragement can you give for people during this time?
This too will pass. You know, we just need patience with it. Once we get there, we'll get the vaccine and we'll move forward with it. Everyone's hurting, but the key thing is keep a good outlook on life. Mm. Take the time to, I guess, improve yourself if you have a lot of time on your hands. But just know that this too will pass. You know, things look bad now, but they will get better. And that's the good thing about being human beings. You know, we're the most adaptable creature on the earth, and we'll get through all this. And we'll be back. Everybody will be back once things get back to normal, hopefully stronger, better, and then with new ways of doing things. That's one thing I definitely learned from this experience. There's different ways of doing things. It's, you know, shaking the tree, and then you adapt, you overcome, and you improvise, and that's what we got to do during these times, and to make it all through.
Yeah, that's so true. We've adapted. We've done these videos. We've upped our online platform. We've adapted quite a bit, added so many different things. I have gotten to talk to some really, really fascinating people, and gotten to hear their stories. And it's been really interesting. It's been something that I would not normally have gotten to do. It's been an honor to talk to some of the leaders in our community. So the human race has gotten through worse. We will make it through this, and we will figure something out. We have the technology now to do some really wonderful things. We will make it through it. Thank you for that. Arthur, let's pull up their social media, their website. Let's put all that on there for them. OutShineFilm.com. And then their Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter accounts as well. So, Victor, any last words? I appreciate you talking to us today. We anticipate the films, and we know there's some fun things coming that you are working very hard to produce.
Yeah, just come to the website, outshinefilm.com. We start Thursday, August 30th, August 20th, with the drive-in, and then virtual after that. One thing I do want to add, because it's been questions I guess we haven't made clear, like I said, the films are available, the virtual films, up to 4 days after their release. So let's say our closing night film, August 30th, gets released at 7 p.m. It's available Monday the 31st, Tuesday the 1st, Wednesday the 2nd, and Thursday the 3rd. So the festival will be technically over, but you can still watch the films past the close date. They'll be available there. So just know that you're not tied to when we want to release it. If you can't make it then, you can definitely watch it after, and there's two films happening at the same time. Watch one when it gets released, and watch the other one the following day.
Yeah,
and enjoy the film.
We're all home. It's something great to do.
Yeah.
So, thank you. All right. Well, thank you, Victor. You can also text OCQ to 228-28 to stay updated and for more information on OutClick. And we are outclick.com for our information, all of our content. So, Victor, thank you so much for joining us today, and we wish you the best with this year's film festival, which is not going to be just Miami, not Fort Lauderdale, but it's going to be all of Florida and an international film festival. So we look forward to you expanding your horizons in a new way possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you.